While watching Foster's Bento's FMK series recent episode, where they were talking about episode 3 of Darling in the Franxx, Ben said the following thing that got me thinking.
I realized what my biggest problem with this show is, and it's because of what you brought up last time about this metaphor with, like, social whatevers. That's my problem, is this show only works on the metaphorical level. No, it has to make sense on a straight-ahead literal level before you can have this metaphor.
Now the question is, really? Does it? I don't want to argue taste here, and Ben is clearly just stating why he doesn't like it. But I want to make a point here too, about the irrelevance of in-world coherence and functioning textuality in heavily metaphorical stories. What are stories but an account of events that may or may not have occurred being recited to you? I'd say much more. There is value in a story that literally is, this is a fun pirate's adventure, or this vast conflict in which giant robots are used to fight the war. The element of escapism and fantasy is there, and it is an overall relaxing, creatively engaging experience. I say all that, but I don't see much value in it for myself. I am unfortunately one of those jaded, highbrow, pretentious literature majors who mostly only appreciates a story if it delivers subtext, either historical, cultural, or emotional. I completely reject the notion that a story is only about the story, as in the events that occur in order and are being told. And furthermore, and this might be the thesis statement of this video, I disagree that a story needs to make textual sense in order to be a subtextual masterpiece. Let me just start by providing classic examples. Just think about any other heavily metaphoric story. Let's take The Metamorphosis by Franz Kafka. For those uncultured swine among you who aren't familiar with weird early 20th century expressionist fiction, this story is about a guy named Gregor Samsa who one morning awakes in his bed to find he has transformed into a giant bug. This sucks for his family because he was the one earning all the money, because his old father retired early. His family is now pissed at him and treats him like shit, and dad gets back to work and gets stronger than ever. Would you say The Metamorphosis is trash because the metaphor that the guy turns into a bug doesn't make sense on a textual level? Nobody ever explains really why he turns into a bug. Nobody cares to explain if that universe might have magic that caused it. So what does this do to you as a reader? We ask ourselves, wait, that is weird. That's not how the world's supposed to work. Why does this weird shit happen? And that's the point where the author explicitly urges you to look behind the facade and search out the metaphor. Because at that point he says, listen buddy, this is not about a man turning into a bug. This is about a societal problem of putting the burden of financially sustaining the family on one man and what it does to the father and son relationship if all that burden needs to be put on the son, and especially if the son cannot handle it. That is what makes Kafka's writing so genius. None of this story is worth a damn on the textual level. You aren't sitting there in suspense waiting for the next plot twist or interesting development. It is an examination of a metaphor that is trying to say something about human nature, family and psychology, and about the burden society puts on the male head of the family. Okay, fine, Kafka and expressionism are weird, not the strongest point, right? Let's look at another example where the textual level does make sense, but I want to explain why it ultimately does not matter. Let's talk The Sandman by E.T.A. Hoffman. What? You're telling me you don't know the early proto-horror fiction writer of early 19th century Germany literary dark romanticism? Shame on you, dude. Get your head in the game. So, he's an early horror author, and The Sandman was written 2 years before Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, which is arguably one of the first actual horror novels ever. But Hoffman predates it. Whatever. The history of horror and sci-fi in the case of both these books is a topic for another video. Let's get to summarizing. So, The Sandman is about a guy whose whole life has been encountering a person he calls The Sandman, which leads to psychological distress for him, because one of his first encounters with him ended in his father dying. To this day, every time The Sandman appears, he reveals something of the deep desires and repressed emotions the protagonist has. This leads to the protagonist slowly losing his mind over the course of the book. This is the most basic summary I can come up with. I personally feel it reflects the most important aspect of the book. But notice how I really did not mention many sequences of events. I did not describe other characters, even though they textually play a huge role. I did not describe he did this and then he did that. No. I actually provided you with a description of the overarching metaphor that is relevant throughout all encounters with the Sandman. Why? Well, I honestly see no value in describing the encounters in detail, because they all only serve the point of delivering a new twist on the metaphor. it textually works, but I couldn't care less. It is good, but it's not what is good about this book.
So I realized in post while editing that I actually did not explain the metaphor at all, and I don't know how much detail I should put in here, so listen to my ramblings for a bit. The metaphor of the Sandman is basically in many instances tied to the various character narratives, but overarching it is a throwback to a childhood trauma that the protagonist re-experiences when the imaginary figure of the Sandman enters his life in any way. In that moment, he recalls the feeling of powerlessness he felt when some strange friend of his father killed his father when he was a child and he witnessed the murder. This theme stays throughout all of this story and repeats over and over in different scenarios concerning his life. So add that mentally to my story summary and all my points will make more sense. I somehow forgot it.
In case you know the Sandman and think I'm making shit up, even Sigmund fucking Freud, master of modern psychology himself, has written a whole essay analyzing the metaphor in this book with his whole penis thing, you know? Yes, for him the story literally is about castration, go figure. But he mentions some interesting points about the uncanny, which incidentally is also the title of his essay about the Sandman. But that's also too much stuff to talk about in this video right here. Since I kinda want this channel to be more about anime than just weird old literature, I decided to also include two examples of the glorious arts of Japanimation land. Gurren Lagann and Evangelion. Whoa, two mecha shows associated by staff with Darling of the Franxx. See guys, I'm doing a thing here. I'm giving you a spoiler warning for those two though, since I assume nobody cares enough about old books. I didn't do it for them, but here. Please skip to the time displayed on screen right now to get to the conclusion of the video. Gurren Lagann makes no fucking sense textually. They constantly pull shit out of their asses, pay homage to some random old shows, literally break every rule in the universe, which actually is the point, and generally shit all over textual coherence. Oh, it does have some aspects that really make sense, like most of the political plots, be it Simon and Carmina's home cave, or Rossio's little arc with his cave people being oppressed, or the Spiral King oppressing all the cave people, or later Rossio's political plot against Simon. Those make textual sense. But those aren't at all what I care about when I watch Gurren Lagann. Tengen Toppa Gurren Lagann makes no goddamn sense, but it's my favorite anime ever. Why? Because of the emotional subtext. Do the impossible, break the unbreakable. These are literally not doable in a textual sense. The point is to break out of negative thinking schemes, of reinforcing your own negativity in your own mind, of preventing yourself from your own possibilities and greatness by only thinking about the things you and your limited point of view consider impossible or not achievable. Gurren Lagann is about taking control and aggressively breaking through all the seemingly impossible walls of society, of the universe, but most importantly, of yourself. Your own psychological walls you build around yourself once you say something is impossible. That is the emotional theme throughout all of Gurren Lagann, and it's so amazing. Who cares if they break every rule the textual world has set up? Who cares if they make up stupid shit as they go? Evangelion is another kind of example. Watching it the first time, I desperately struggled to tie together all the plot details thrown around like crazy. All about Zayla, all the computer stuff, the history of multiple impacts and whatever the fuck is up with this weird artifact. But then I decided, no, I don't care. That's just too much stuff. And then I read a very long forum post detailing exactly what the scene at the end of Evangelion meant, where Shinji chokes Asuka, where someone neatly tied it together with Hegelian philosophy and wrote a whole bunch about how we construct identity by conflict with others. And yeah, that neatly ties together most of Evangelion's points. Without the tiring in-world shit. I appreciate the fact that the Eva units are their mothers much more as a metaphor than as an in-universe literal thing, because that is just fucking stupid. Enough examples, let's summarize. I told you how weird shit that doesn't work in the universe triggers an intentional reaction of looking behind the text in Kafka's works. How a metaphor can often be a much better summary of what a story means with the Sandman. Of how a good subtextual resonance can lead to you completely disregarding any nonsense in the story with Gurren Lagann. And how you can learn to say fuck it to confusing, overly complex plots by focusing on the themes and metaphors underlying it all with Evangelion. And I would not say that Darling in the Franxx is on that level at all. But I sure hope it will be at some point. I mean, I might be the only one who reads basically all Trigger / Gainax shows that deeply. And in my eyes, Kill la Kill is about basically fighting capitalism. So that tells you a lot of what kind of person I am. And that might be another video I make at some point. But at the moment, Darling of the Franxx is nonetheless disappointing for me so far. They really need to start weaving a much deeper metaphor and actually provide some points instead of just making everything look like fucking. I still have some faith though. If it starts improving in this regard, there might be a follow-up video coming where I might analyze some of these themes that interest me.